Hey, we are here in the center, the epicenter of Silicon Valley. Yes, we are, folks. People, we are here at this beautiful hotel, and I am having a conversation with Lisa Chu. Now, Lisa has been many incarnations of many different things. She's been an angel investor, a doctor, a teacher of violin to little kids. She had her own school, and she's an artist extraordinaire. So we're going to be here talking about the whole thing, life and the beauty of living. So I'm going to give it over to Lisa, and we're going to have a great conversation. Thanks for joining us. What is the thing that makes people, instead of just talking about changing their lives, take real action?
Great question. It's something I think about a lot because I've worked for some years as a coach to people. So doing a lot of talking with people about how to change, what are the new mindsets of change. But I'm always curious about what is the moment in people's lives that finally inspires them to take action, because it's very different to talk about change versus doing it. For me, and I think there's a different answer for everyone, but for me personally, what made me receptive to taking in the new information about change was being in pain, you know, having my current life become so painful physically and otherwise that I was willing to try almost anything to do things differently. And for me, the only way to really name it is burnout. At the time, it was just, you know, a lot of working harder at something, hoping that after a certain point, things would change if I just worked hard enough. And that was sort of the mantra that I had taken on from. It was, the only thing I can call it is burnout. It was a feeling of physical exhaustion in a way that I hadn't experienced before. And it was, the only strategy I knew at the time was just to work harder and be quote unquote more successful, thinking that it would get better if I just reached the next milestone. And when that wasn't working, it really was just reaching a point of surrender where I was open to hearing any new way and trying it, because everything that I'd tried wasn't working. So I hope the question inspires whoever's watching to ask, you know, what in your life has become painful enough for you to be open to change? Because we really have to tap into some reserves of courage that are not demanded of us in daily life in order to make change. It's doing something new. I mean, by definition, it's going into territory that's never been walked before. There may not even be a map of it. And to do that in a conventional system seems crazy, but it's what, you know, your soul is calling for. That's all I can say about that.
So, Lisa, that was such a great answer. This makes me think about reaching your pain point in all of the trauma that we go through. Yes, we see those people behind us in life, but we don't listen to it and just let ourselves feel it. And here we are in Silicon Valley, and it's just always been, you know, I'd like to talk about this, that there's a lot of logical solve the problem. How does it work in life to view life so linear like that?
Well, it's funny that you talk about this as the epicenter of technology. It's always been the nature of California that drew me here, and the technology mindset has always been very foreign to me. But I just got back from a conference in San Francisco, which was a week of technologists talking to technologists. But my perspective was looking at how that all impacts society. You know, where does technology intersect with society? And I think my observation is that computer logic, which is where everything is moving to ones and zeros, and running things only via logic, because that's the only thing that, that computer language can understand, it really neglects a huge piece of our own human brains, which we know are only 2% of our brain capacity is logic, and the rest is imagination, intuition, and other things we don't even understand yet from the neuroscience. And we also know that our neurological system is not just in our brain, it's actually throughout our body. We have neurons in our gut and in our heart. We know this, but we don't understand how they work together. But we know that there are as many neurons in our gut as there are in our brain. So that we're receiving signals from our whole body all the time that the ones and zeros have not found a way to accommodate. So the fact that, you know, what I was telling you that I realized today is the fundamental mindset that I don't believe is not the right word, but I just don't run my life this way. I don't see the world as a problem to be solved. I see the world as a wonder to behold. And I know that some people that might sound Pollyanna or childish or innocent, but I actually, having immersed myself in children's literature for the last year or so, I see that as value that we cannot exclude from the human experience, the innocence and the magic and the wonder of what the world is around us versus the constant attempt to manipulate and control and solve that world, which is a mindset that when we're in it, we can't see. Because if we were to see it, we would no longer be in the mindset of everything is a problem to be solved. So that's, I think, one of the biggest challenges is to get people out of their rooted ways of seeing things. And we talk about getting out of the comfort zone. And I think that's one example of recognizing that we each have a way of seeing the world that we are attached to at some level. And to have conversations across those boundaries with people that have different points of view and allow ourselves to be changed by that in some way. And so that's, you know, what I'm pushing myself to do is not to judge and condemn the technological way of thinking, but somehow to try to have a conversation with it.
Okay. Yeah.
To explore that rather than saying they're wrong and I'm right. To try to bring my point of view into their world and see what comes back. And it's a big challenge, but I feel this, the world of wonder and imagination, and really not shying away from the things that are not reducible to logic.
Yeah.
Meaning, you know, so just to give an example, an article that I read about someone, an ethics professor that proposed requiring ethics as a part of computer science training and teaching. And so the experience of teaching actual computer science engineers ethics was great, you know, very interesting, but we don't know how to apply this to computers, which speak in terms of ones and zeros. So really interesting class, interesting material, but we're going to throw it away because it's not applicable. We don't understand how to translate that to a computer language, which I think captures the whole problem, which is we're just going to throw that out because it doesn't apply. rather than saying, how do we incorporate nuance into the way we approach the design of technology? And that, you know, it's a process of stepping back from what we're doing and not just continuing to do the same thing over and over again, but bringing in new ideas and saying, wow, maybe we have missed a whole component of human experience that we're not designing into these technological systems.
So this makes me think, Lisa, of about throwing the blueprint away and being really uncomfortable. And the first thing that came to mind is we both sold everything and started over again. So I'd love to talk to you about that. What did that do to you to go through your attachment? So here you go.
Okay. Well, that reminds me of one of the first encounters that I had. Not one of the first, because I remember the very first encounter we had at Jungle Digital.
Me too.
But when you were moving, I think you were going to India for the second time or going on your second adventure and letting go of things and talking about a table that like you were about to sell it on Craigslist, but it wasn't just about the table. It was like everything that the table represented and everything you remembered about it and how hard it was to let go of that, and shoes and jewelry. And about 2 years after that, or maybe a year, I went through the same thing where I just spent a month nonstop, like as a 40-hour-a-week job, going to my apartment every day at 8 o'clock in the morning and leaving at 5, just getting rid of stuff. Wow. And it took me that long. I was realizing that certain things I had to pay money to get rid of. I mean, I had bought them, but then it's not that easy to get rid of. You actually have to pay somebody to come and move it and give it away.
What'd you call that guy? Junk King?
That was the name of it, Junk King. But I discovered Free Cycle for the first time, and I watched people joyfully come to my apartment and take things. Like, I gave away every single thing in my kitchen, and there were stories of people that were giving these to new immigrants that came and everything, and microwaves that were going to students in apartments. And I was so thankful that these people came to take them. This was after like hours and hours and days of loading up my car and driving to Goodwill, and like certain things they don't even take at Goodwill and all these things. And I remember before that month, I spent many months, a year and a half actually, just like walking like a zombie through my apartment, knowing that I had to move on. But also every single thing in my apartment was screaming to me these storylines about how I could never get rid of them. Like, one of the tables was one of the first expensive tables that my brother ever bought for himself. And then he gave it to me and he never wanted me to give it away because it was a stickly table. And I was like, nice table, but is this table the thing that's going to keep me rooted to this life that's just doesn't fit anymore, and it's time for me to do something else, even though I didn't know what that was necessarily?
Yeah.
What I found was that overcoming that hurdle, you have to do the first step. There's this poem by David White that's called Start Close In. Mm-hmm. And it's one of the lines is, take the first step, not the second or the third. Start close in. And often it's that first step that we don't want to take,
yeah,
that is holding us back from everything after that, which is the magic of our, you know, our destiny, our life, the adventure of life. And for me, it was those tables. It was the table, the couch, the, you know, all these large pieces of furniture that symbolized to me, some of them symbolize my success, but a lot of them were just baggage from my family about things that they had achieved and they handed off to me. It's like, why couldn't they get rid of the table? Like, why did I have to be the one to hold on to their memories?
Yeah.
And of course, they did it out of good intention and kindness and generosity to me, but then it became a burden.
Yeah.
And those were huge things for me to get over. And you know, now, 7 years after that, I find myself kind of in another comfort zone of my own creation and feeling a very strong pull to the next thing, whatever that is. And again, feeling a different version of that attachment to, look at my life. Nobody would ever complain about the life that I have right now. And why would I ever let it go? But some of it is about just embracing the fact that I'm an adventurer and an explorer, and the traveling and the newness of being in a place, seeing things through new eyes all the time, is part of what feeds me. Yeah. And to be really honest about that is difficult when I was taught and shown a different way of living my whole life.
Oh, yeah.
And I was told that the virtuous life is the one that has these things, stability, you know, a mortgage, a car, the kids in the schools, and the blah, 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 all the conventional things. And that's right for some people, and that works for a lot of some, for some people. But I think being honest with ourselves and finding our own guidance is essential. And we're, I think, not encouraged enough. And maybe this generation, the millennials and younger, have more encouragement to be unique and be themselves. But for, you know, my generation and your generation, our generation, weren't as encouraged to do our own thing without fear or shame or any of that. I felt, and I still feel, this unconscious pull to fit into something that I can't even define.
So that brings me to think about how life is really about making it up as you go along. And this is what I've been doing in my own life. And I would love to talk to you about it too, how you don't know what's coming down the road. And I know from my own artistic endeavors, that's how it's all come about. And my travel, that I don't have the answer. One time somebody asked me, do you go places because people tell you to go? And I'm like, no, never. So, you know, it's a great conversation to talk about listening to yourself and stretching yourself as a person, which can be scary, and you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I'd love to hear about from you your artistic expression that you're doing now, which is so great. These paintings that you're doing, the show that you're putting on, that's... I'd love to hear more about those beautiful faces that you're painting.
Well, what you just said about the visual artifact of my process, I mean, that's what I've really found in my art. I started putting paint to paper 3 years ago for the first time in my life. I never saw myself as somebody who could draw or paint. It's something I tried as a result of this attitude of making it up as you go along, which was new to me. And that kind of gets into the past of kind of living a life of classical music and sort of a very prescribed way of living, and a prescribed route to success and a pretty narrow definition of what success is and what it looks like. And then moving into this open space of improvisation and making up as I go along, which was like really the most fear-filled moment of my life. And I don't know if I've told you this story. I've told it in a lot of the interviews. That's why I assume I've told everyone. But the moment where I was shaken awake to that was in a workshop that, you know, I was in this period of burnout and I was open to everything, and I ended up in two different programs. One was a life coach training program and one was a sound healing program, which I signed up for not knowing what they were. Sound healing sounded good. I was a musician and I had been in medicine. So I was like, okay, those two things combined, great. Yeah. And one of the weekends was the art of improvisation, which I thought, I'll just go and be a good student, but I don't really have to do it because that's what somebody else does. I'm not an improviser. That's what for jazz people do. I had all these definitions in my mind of what I was and was not. And of course, I plan to hide behind the instructor during the improvisation part. And at that moment, and someone told me to bring my violin, and I obeyed, but I was like, I'm not going to use this. But I had my violin and was hiding behind the instructor. And at that moment, everyone in the room, like 30 people, were doing this kind of blues thing. And then the instructor turned around, pointed to me, and said, "You solo." And I was like, I have no, it was the worst thing that could have ever happened to me because I didn't know what to do. And I really felt, this is not who I am. This is not what I do. Why is he doing this to me? But I was on the spot. It was in the moment. And he knew that I was stuck. And he said to me these four words, which are still the most compassionate words a teacher has ever spoken to me. He said, "Play the wrong note." And right there, he pierced through to my worst fear and gave me permission to step across that line in a way that no authority figure had ever done in my life. And it was like a lightning bolt where I realized everything I'd ever done in my life was about doing it right. As defined by who? Never questioned it. Mm-hmm. It was just someone told me it was right, so I did. I went for it. Yeah. And nobody ever said, explore this territory. And then even at that moment, I was like, which wrong note do you want me to play? There's a lot of wrong notes. Like, there's only one right note, you know, when you go by that way of thinking, but play the wrong note. Like, there's not just one, there's like many. And that was the whole point, that there's an infinite universe outside this idea of right that we're never encouraged to explore through conventional society. Because by definition, if you tell people to question the rules, it's scary. So, at that moment, I was still paralyzed. I didn't, you know what to do. So he actually took my finger, placed it on a place on the violin where he knew I wouldn't like the sound. He was a cellist, so he knew. He held my finger there and he said, "Play that." And my bow arm wouldn't move. So I was wired in my body not to do certain things, like down to the physical level. So that really showed me the power of practice, which kind of brings me to what we were talking about earlier in terms of what we're practicing is everything we're doing in our daily lives is what we're practicing, consciously or unconsciously. And I think when we talk about going outside of the comfort zone, it's becoming very conscious about what we practice, because something that's become unconscious is comfortable. It's a familiar. It's our habit. It's a reflex. It's something that happens without our having to be engaged in it at all. But what I realized from that moment with the violin is, you know, I wasn't born knowing how to play the violin. I started from scratch at 3, and I built up to that point through practice. So if I could get to the point at age 35 where I'd practiced to the point where I physically couldn't do certain things, then I could start at age 35 and practice to the point at some point in the future where I'm physically doing different things. So is that was the light bulb, and it didn't happen in that workshop where I all of a sudden became Bobby McFerrin or something. You know, I didn't just jump into becoming an expert improviser. It's something that I decided at that moment, and I had the choice. I had the choice to walk through that door or not. And I did decide at that moment to walk through the door. It did require me to put down the violin for several months and not touch it and just work in areas where I didn't have as much training, where there wasn't as many rooted ideas of what's right and wrong, and to train my body and breath and voice to just do scary things that I would have called ugly or wrong, and get used to it and not to judge it so much, but listen. And so listening to that, those, you know, so the way I did it was through a voice practice of doing vocal improvisation, where it wasn't necessarily about songs, it was sound. Mm-hmm. And starting with a step of just listening. Yeah. Being willing to listen without judging. Mm-hmm. And to discover new areas of myself. And that grew into my visual art practice, which started with putting anything on a piece of paper that didn't have to represent anything, that it was just whatever, the movement of my hand across a page. And only recently I started to try to represent things and to express more precisely something like a face. I mean, this project I did in January, I'd never done a face before. A human tried to do a face of an actual person. But something drew me to this list of women who had been inspiring throughout history and throughout the world. And many of these women I didn't know, so I had to look up and research who they were, what they did, and try to capture that essence in a single image. And I love that challenge of telling a story in an image and stretching my own comfort zone of, I've never done a face, much less a human, a famous person that people knew, and doing it in my way. So you can see that I played with a lot of different styles and approaches. And I discovered a lot of different things about myself during the month in terms of, we talked about just having a focus and the value of that, of putting my art and creativity first in my life, and how much progress I made through that discipline of practice and putting basically myself first. And I'm gratified to hear that you can see it, you know, in the visual imprint of that. But it really was, for me, much more about challenging myself and just wanting, not in a way that anyone else was measuring me. Yeah. It was about that feeling of satisfaction of getting closer to representing these women in a way that when I look at the images, I see them and I also see me. So that's what that project was about, and thank you for seeing that.
I got more to say.
The paintings are amazing. For someone to say that she's never done faces are so hard, and these are amazing. They're at Bamboo Hair and Body in Half Moon Bay. They're up until May. You got to see them. I mean, just on Instagram, I was completely amazed. Lisa Chu is your Instagram, isn't it? Dr. Lisa Chu. See what I'm saying? She's got many incarnations. And I forgot about the life coaching, which is a big thing that she helps people with her life, and consulting. But I wanted to mention, thinking about these women that you painted, it made me think of how all of them have done very unconventional things and listened to themselves, even when people were probably telling them they were crazy, which I know I've heard plenty in my own life. And you can't listen to it, because if you're told, oh yeah, you get a husband, you get the house, you get the child, you get the car and the good job. And so many people follow that and don't question it. So we need to question that more and stretch ourselves. And I think the humanities can help us, as we were talking about. Not to say that science is bad, but humanities kind of gets a bad rap, and I think we need to see it in a new way. What do you think?
The humanities. So I came from an upbringing that completely worshipped at the altar of science, and I always was very curious about why my parents were obsessed with pushing the sciences. They were both scientists, even though my mother came from two parents who were historians. They were total humanities people. Like my grandfather was an author of 40 books in Chinese about Chinese history, mostly biographies, you know, history told through the lens of people's life stories, which is ironic because that's what I'm interested in. Even though I was pushed totally towards science and was pushed to study two musical instruments. So it was kind of like they knew that there was some importance of the arts, but that you couldn't rely on it. And I think that's something that we talked about earlier, is, you know, that we received these conflicting messages like, do what you love, but do something reliable with a salary that is, you know, that you can count on. And that was that's how I ended up being convinced that I had to go to medical school. It was something that, it was never said overtly, but there was this clear expectation in my mind that my life would not be complete if I didn't get a medical degree. I don't know why. But so that's what I did. And even though I know that my favorite classes in college were the humanities, and if I was really honest with myself, that's what I wanted to study. Yeah. But I had received this instruction from my parents and just kind of the atmosphere that either you could do that when you retire, or you could study it on your own. But why don't you study something useful, which was equaled the sciences. So, I mean, I still look back at my college years, and I went to Harvard, which was a great, rich place to study anything. But I ended up doing this thing that I really didn't care about, which was, you know, lab research, cutting mice tails up and, you know, doing all this stuff that was like, why am I doing this? But I kind of followed this expectation that I had to, even if I had no real interest. But I was so used to it. Again, getting back to practice, I had practiced doing things I didn't want to do for a long time. And there's actually some value in that. I mean, I think that you can go the other way to the other extreme, which is having no ability to stretch into something that you don't want to do is also not productive. So we're kind of talking about this dance between listening to the pull of intuition, which I think if we're all really honest and get quiet, we know what that is. If you ask most people, they know what an intuition is, but they also have really well-practiced strategies of how to just push it away and push it down, and find ways to medicate the pain away through distraction or real medication. But somehow decoding your own language of intuition, you know, how does it speak to you? What does it sound like? And then doing the scary process of experimenting, of saying, okay, what if I actually follow in some small way what that intuition is saying? Can I set up a small experiment in my life to try it and see what happens? And you know what I'm always inspired by your journeys is the ways that you listen and try things and then always learn something new that you take with you, even if you go back to certain things, you're new when you go back to them, you know, having learned through your adventures. And that becoming new, renewing yourself is so important to growing. And I don't even remember what the original question was, but the humanities. And why, and so I think what the humanities and the arts teach us is the zone between the zero and the one. You know, there's a whole infinity in between those numbers. You know, that it's not just black and white or one or the other. It's this whole range of nuance that nature shows us, that stories show us. And that's, I think, the power, always the power of a story of a human being or the complexity of nature, that no matter how much we try to reduce it down to one thing or the other, it's never going to comply with that oversimplification. And that's what I think is so important as we push the STEM, you know, science, technology, engineering, and math, is that the whole message. And, you know, that's when we try to go for a marketing message that boils things down to something, a slogan that people can take in a headline. That's what we're seeing with social media and everything, that, wow, you know, is that headline true or false? Well, I don't think there's any headline that can actually capture the truth completely. Yeah. And that's why we can never find total satisfaction in just a slogan or a headline. But there's actually more complexity to experience and the world that cannot fit in 140 characters. Sorry. And, you know, that's I think the quest and the glorification of that quest to boil things down is a trap that leads us to neglect entire swaths of human experience. And so the pace that humanity's demands of us, which is slower and deeper, is what I'm seeing that I'm becoming an advocate for. That somehow, you know, in my own creative process, my own development as an artist, my own learning about what it takes to create a life that supports creative process, that, you know, I aspire to someday being able to speak about the importance of that and what it has brought to my life and my perspective on the world. You know, and I don't pretend to have that now. I just have, you know, where I am now, which is, it's been a lot of learning to sort of, to step out of what other people consider the tried and true model. And to sort of go out into the place that has not been written. And, you know, the metaphor I have for that is the blank page. And that's really the creative process, that anyone who is creating and not imitating, it is about confronting the blank page over and over again. Because once you've written on that page, it's not over, it's the next blank page. And the next one. And so becoming accustomed to that, all the feelings that come up with the blank page. And I actually did a class once that was called The Blank Page, and it drew a lot of interest, but it was more about talking about fears versus, okay, here's a blank page. And when we got to that part, it was like, is she really going to make us do something? And yeah, that's the only way I've found to confront it. You can talk about and read about the fear of the blank page, but you will not overcome your own fear of it until you actually face it and make some mark on that page. Yeah. And experience whatever comes up for you and be willing to stay with it rather than run away or stop. Which is the default response. Either I don't like that feeling, I'm going to go do something that's easier and will be more secure, or or I'm just going to, you know, make that feeling go away some other way. So whenever we're doing any creative activity, it is about staying with all the feelings that come up that make us want to stop.
So one thing I wanted to say about the trauma and the feelings are, it's so widespread that there's a lot of pain and suffering in the world mentally, but we tend to kind of go towards just the physical pain and suffering because we can see it, but inside may even be worse. I mean, people are dealing with really hard childhoods, and to stay with that and feel the hard feelings, yeah, I'd love to talk with you about healing and ways to handle it.
Well, yeah, I mean, I first of all, having gone through medical school, Western medical school, you know, you think of medicine as healing, but what I really learned after medical school, not practicing medicine, but going through my life coaching training and the sound healing, is what healing really is. And the medical model is fixing, solving, getting rid of, you know, let's take it out, or let's give you a pill that makes the symptoms go away. But let's not talk about what's underneath the symptoms or what might be going on in your in your own behaviors that can be altered to help this process along also. We know that most disease conditions are chronic conditions that can't be well addressed by a single pill. That's why people are on multiple medications. But the whole training of doctors up until recently hasn't really equipped doctors to talk to people about how to change their lives and alter their health. It's now, you know, slowly coming to the surface. But again, it's the same model that I would say is used in technology, which is find the problem and solve it. Because what healing is actually much slower and much messier in a way, because it's not just one day you go in and the next day your condition is gone. It's actually this dance between the external and the internal, and developing, again, this, the, I call it learning a new language. You know, learning the language of your own body. What's your body saying to you? And there's no book to look it up. I mean, there have been books written that say, that claim that, but just because someone else's body says something to them doesn't mean it necessarily applies to you. Yeah. So you can take in information that other people have gathered from their experience, mm-hmm. but it won't necessarily apply to you. And that's very frustrating to people looking for an answer. And don't want to do the research into their own experience. Yeah. So I have found that healing is actually having this ability to create a space for yourself to do that decoding of the language of your body, of your life, doing the experiments. And, you know, I feel very lucky that my life path has given me the chance to have that space. You know, many different circumstances aligned for me to be able to explore and to learn. And it's a really good reminder, Mary, thank you, that those of us who've had that chance to create space in our lives to heal and to learn, you know, we can really share that experience and help other people, not by giving them an answer, but by reminding them that they can heal. Yeah. You know, just that idea that, wow, it's possible, can be a catalyst for someone. Because, you know, you talk about trauma. I think most of the damage that's done by trauma is the silencing that comes from the shame of, you know, not wanting to talk about it, or not having the space, the non-judgmental space in our lives to break down and feel and go through the pain and realize that we can survive that. We can survive the very difficult feelings and not be judged and not be killed and not be attacked, which are all trauma responses. I think the damage from trauma comes from just suppressing and pushing it down, thinking that if we don't talk about it and don't deal with it, that it goes away. But my experience is that it's expressed in some other way. Okay. So the topic of healing and trauma is actually, I think, really relevant, because many of us are locked in a trauma pattern where our lives are ruled by reactions to the past, or not even our own experience maybe, but ancestral. And so we believe in these embedded stories of impending doom, and we stay within the boundaries of that, and our world gets smaller. And through no fault of our own, we just stay locked in a pattern. And I think it takes tremendous courage to heal, because healing involves an expansion of our worlds and of possibilities and movement and transformation, and all of that is very scary to our habitual mind. And so yeah, I think, you know, I was saying earlier that it is a privilege to have the opportunity to heal and to share the story. And I guess, you know, what I would say about that from my own experience is it's totally worth it to expand and grow into more of the truth of yourself. And again, to be able to see the world as a wonder to behold versus a problem to be solved. And we can, you know, it's like putting on a pair of glasses. We can see the entire world as problems and that we have to solve them all. And we can become quickly overwhelmed by that, or kind of take it on as our mission to solve things. Or we can see the world as this wonder. And I think there was a quote from Einstein that you can either see the world as a miracle I don't even include this because I don't remember the quote, but something about like either everything is a miracle or nothing is a miracle. But I think the point is that when we get too rooted in one or the other, when we lose the balance and go toward, you know, everything is ones and zeros and solvable, or, you know, there's no role for logic. I think both of those are imbalanced, that we have to acknowledge that there is some, there's an organization to the world and there's mystery. And that both of those interacting together create the experience that we call life. And we all need to be in conversation with people that hold different pieces of the fabric of life to feel whole. And that's, you know, the roots of the word healing and of yoga. It's union and coming together and bringing different aspects, perhaps contrasting aspects, together and weaving them into a new fabric. And that's what life is.